Hello everybody and greetings from Denmark. I'm Erik Jørgensen and I'm with TICRA in Copenhagen, where we specialize in algorithms and software for antennas and scattering problems, and that's with a particular focus on space applications. For the next 35 minutes, I will show you some of the developments we have made to address these challenging problems. So welcome to this talk that we have named Computational Electromagnetics in Space. So the first thing you might ask is CEM for space really that different from any other areas where we apply CEM? And the answer is yes. If we look at a typical telecommunication satellite, for example, VSAT-1 that we see here, we see that we have a lot of antennas in a very limited space. They're electrically large, they're open region problems, and we need very high accuracy because the dynamic range can be very large, for example, 100 dBs. Also, we have many degrees of freedom to optimize on all these antennas, and we must have full control on the uncertainties, for example, manufacturing tolerances. Basically, one algorithm cannot do all this at the same time, so we have to look at two different types of algorithms. One type of algorithm is for design verification, where accuracy is our top priority, and another type of algorithm is for design optimization and tolerance analysis, where speed is our top priority. And that's basically the agenda of my talk today. In the first half, I will talk about a CEM algorithm for design verification. That's a high accuracy, general purpose integral equation solver. We'll go through all the disciplines mentioned there: meshing, current discretization, acceleration, mesh robustness, and out-of-core solutions. Then in the last half of the talk, I'll talk about CEM algorithms for optimization and uncertainty quantification. That requires ultra-fast specialty solvers, for example, for reflector antennas, antennas with rotational symmetry, passive microwave components, and quasi-periodic surfaces. So first, I'll talk about the high-accuracy integral equation solver. The steps required to develop this algorithm are listed here. First, we formulate the requirements that we mentioned before: high accuracy, electrically large problems, the continuous integral equation, the discretization steps, we'll use the method of moments, the solution, it's iterative and preconditioned, the acceleration, we'll use MLF-MEM, and we also need an algorithm for fast current integration, and then robustness, we need to deal with non-connected meshes in situations where we are out of memory, where we need to use out-of-core solutions. And when we start to work on that, we'll realize that we have to go back and rework the whole thing, starting from the continuous integral equation and all the remaining steps. Obviously, we don't have time to go through all this today, so we'll just focus on three things: discretization, acceleration, and robustness. First, concerning the discretization, we'll note that the key issue to arrive at a high-accuracy integral equation solver is to use a higher-order approach. This is illustrated here in the plot to the right. The typical integral equation solver will use linear basis function corresponding to the red curve. So if we want to arrive at a certain error level, for example, 10 to the minus 3, you can see that you need a lot of basis function to pull the error down to this level. Whereas if you instead are on the fifth order curve, for example, this one, you only need a modest amount of basis function to pull down the error to the desired level of 10 to the minus 3. So this implies that it's much better to increase the polynomial order P than to decrease the mesh size H, and this is the key issue when using higher order basis functions, that we need to use very large patches with a lot of smooth basis function on each patch. In practical problems, we often encounter curvature, implying that we also need higher order patches, as illustrated here. We prefer quads instead of triangles because they usually lead to the lowest number of unknowns. We have found it convenient to use these simple Lagrange patches using between 4 and 25 interpolation points. For example, for a fourth order patch, you will need 25 interpolation points. The patch size can be up to 2x2 wavelengths, but beware, this is a tough choice. There are really no meshing tools available that can do such higher order patches. You're lucky if you can find a second order measure, but fourth order is totally out of the question. So you basically have to develop your own, and that's what we did. We developed a measure based on the paving algorithm by Wagger, You can see here in the little movie how it paves the boundaries. That works well when you have many degrees of freedom, but if you have very few degrees of freedom, you need to supplement it with something else. So to that, we have developed a divide and conquer strategy, which works well when you have a very high geometrical complexity compared to the patch size, as illustrated here down in the left corner. But of course, we also have some cases where we both have regions with many degrees of freedoms and some with geometrical complexity. So you also need a hybrid approach, as illustrated here. Then to the surface currents. So the ideal set of basis functions should fulfill these four requirements. We want them to be high order in order to get the high accuracy. We should have normal current continuity across neighboring patches. They should be hierarchical, implying that we can mix small and large patches in the same mesh. We also want them to be near orthogonal, because that's how you get a low condition number, which will allow you to solve it with a fast iterative solver. So when we started working on this back in 2000, there weren't really anything available that could match all these four requirements. So basis functions were either not hierarchical or they had a horrific condition number. So we came up with this solution based on Legendre polynomials and modified Legendre polynomials. So the modified Legendre polynomials with this tilde here are detailed over here. But we can see that the lowest order functions are the classical rooftop functions, indicated by the black and the green curve here, whereas the higher order terms are the difference between two Legendre polynomials, which implies that they are zero at both ends of the patch, such that they are really local corrections that can be added without interfering with the continuity of the currents between patches. So in that way, we can pump up the expansion order on each patch without compromising the condition number. So from this nice relation, we can also see that these modified polynomials actually results in an orthogonal charge. So these basis functions is what we would have arrived at if we started to have this as a requirement. There are newer basis functions available now that have slightly better orthogonality, but nothing that comes close in terms of simplicity. So with these available, you can plug them into the method of moments and get a very nice higher order MOM. But of course, we need to accelerate the solution. And here MLFMM is the obvious choice because we're talking about electrically large structures. So basically, once you do that, and if you fine-tune the parameters in the MLFMM, you can obtain exactly the same curve for accuracy versus the number of unknowns. So basically, the error is completely dominated by the MOM discretization error. That is, at least if you have full error control of your MLFMM. But when applying MLFMM on top of the high-order basis functions, you don't necessarily get a code that is more efficient. The reason is that the large patches we need for the high-order MOM limits the efficiency of the MLFMM. So many research groups have tried to do that, but found that the optimal order was only second order. So you don't really get the large improvement you want from the higher order. However, if you rework the MLFMM algorithm completely, and in every single step focus the development on the higher order basis function and the large patches, then you can actually get a very efficient MLFMM scheme that does not lose the efficiency when the patch is large. So we did that, for example, by using a very custom sparse matrix storage that exploits the structure that you usually find in the matrix when we're using higher order basis functions. But there are many other steps in the solution. So in order to judge the efficiency, we'll change the plot a bit. So instead of plotting the number of unknowns and the error here, we'll start to look at the computational efficiency of the code instead. So now we are plotting a memory here on the y-axis and the error on the x-axis. So basically this tells us what is the best trade-off, what is the price we pay in memory to get a certain accuracy. So we're just looking at a sphere here, and the red curves are for the standard MLFMM scheme. And if we apply that, we can confirm what other research group had found, that the second order is really the optimal solution because it's lowest here in terms of memory. But with the modified scheme, we see that except for the first order, then all the higher orders are basically equally efficient. So of course we need to do more work when we add a higher order, but we also pull down the error. So overall the trade-off is the same, Basically, all orders can be applied efficiently. So with this modified MLFM scheme, we can see that the memory is basically independent of the basis function order. So of course, you may ask, why bother about orders higher than 2? And the answer is here. When we look at the speed versus the accuracy we need, then we can see that the higher the order, the better the speed. So the optimal choice is definitely to go for the highest possible order, because then we can get a very fast solution. And we remember that the memory is not compromised. Overall, the high order MOM MFMM solver we have developed here works really great for electrically large structures with very large patches. The next topic I'll talk about is about mesh robustness, because when we apply this algorithm to practical cases, we find that the geometry, the input, is usually not perfect. For example, the CAD file may contain edges that are not properly connected, an antenna that we have to attach locally will require a global update of the mesh, or we cannot add meshes coming from different sources because the patches are not compatible along the lines joining the two meshes. The solution to this is to reformulate the continuous integral equation and use a discontinuous Galerkin formulation that allows basically disconnected meshes without loss of accuracy. We had to extend this formulation to the high order basis function, but then it works really great and we can basically treat all these meshes accurately. For example, joining an antenna and a platform without connectivity along the red lines here, or a CAD file with no topological information about the connected edges, or a local refinement of the mesh without doing a global update. The current will flow along such non-connected edges without any artifacts, as illustrated here on the plot, so we can maintain the accuracy even in cases where the meshes are not connected. So in practical situations, we could, for example, use a mesh like this with tons of non-connected patches, antennas that are meshed separately and then joined on the platform later, and a mix of small and large patches. Another nice addition is that you can use an out-of-core solver. Typically in practical situations, you might need just a little bit more memory than you actually have. In that case, you can offload some of the storage to an SSD drive, for example. And the most obvious thing to offload is the near matrix and the preconditioner, because they're only used once in each matrix vector product. And here the higher order MFMM has an advantage, because a relatively large percentage of the memory is actually used for the near matrix and the preconditioner, typically 50%, whereas the standard MFMM, it's typically only 25%. So we can easily read the near matrix and the preconditioner in small chunks and only use it once per iteration. And we should also keep in mind that with the high order formulation, the required memory is already really low. So for comparable accuracy, a better way to show it is probably like that. So if we use an SSD drive and out-of-core storage, we can actually solve great things on smaller computers. Another point here is that if we need higher accuracy, then we can just use P-refinement, that is, increase the polynomial order locally. That will only increase the near matrix, but since that's stored on the SSD drive, we can actually improve the accuracy without using any more memory. So we can check convergence, for example, without running out of memory. Really nice advantage. So solving great things on small computers, that's illustrated here, where we have taken a space telescope, ESA's Planck telescope, and solved it on a really old laptop. It's a 2013 MacBook that you can see here, with just 16 gigs of RAM, but still we can solve a problem like this with about 5 million higher order unknowns. That corresponds roughly to 25 million RWGs. We usually report that number because it's easier to relate to for people that are not used to higher order codes. The required memory is listed here. For the in-core solution, it would be about 50 gigabytes, whereas with the out-of-core solution, we could bring it down to 5 gigabyte, and the solution is available overnight in 12 hours. I have to say here that we have not only stored the near matrix, but also a larger part of the MLFM memory, so we have tried really here to squeeze it down as much as possible. In more realistic scenarios, we are using an in-core solution. Here's, for example, a test satellite from a CAD file. It's about 20 meters long, so this is supposed to resemble a typical telecommunication satellite. We can solve this at all the communication bands used today. And today I'll just show, for example, the KA band and the QE band. So there are a lot of details here, and the frequency is relatively high. We are using an active feed sitting on top of the earth deck here. And at the highest frequency, we'll show the dimensions of this platform. The satellite is shown here, about 4,000 wavelengths along the longest dimension. So at KA band, which is typically the highest frequency used to communication today, the size of this is about 1 million square wavelengths. So we can solve this with 20 million high order unknowns, which is about the equivalent of 100 million RWG unknowns. The solution is available in 8 hours, and we need a 330 gigabyte of memory. So we can solve this on a standard, fairly standard dual Xeon, which is a workstation class high-end PC. We can bring up the frequency even further. Here we go up to QV band. So it's 60 gigahertz. The electrical size is above 4 million square wavelengths. So without RWG unknowns, it would be a 350 million unknown problem. We can solve it in a day with a little more than 1 terabyte of memory. So of course, the mesh is really dense here, as you can see in this insert. Remember that each patch is about 1.5 wavelengths. And again, this is solvable on a dual Xeon workstation. This higher order MFMM solver is really ideal if you have an electrically large structure and you're looking for very high accuracy. This is typically something you would do in the very large states of the antenna design, where you are verifying the design or where you are checking for interference between different antennas on such a platform. However, in other scenarios, the requirements to the CEM algorithms are completely different. So in some situations, you want to optimize the antenna, and we have seen optimization problems with up to 100,000 unknowns related to the feeds, the reflector surfaces, or anything else on such an antenna. So in that case, the requirements are really different. The maximum runtime you can allow is about 1 to 2 seconds. You need the algorithm to have really low memory requirements, and it should, to the extent possible, be a full wave solution. So of course, you need to hybridize different solvers to achieve something like that. So we'll now look into some of the ultra-fast CM algorithms we have developed for that purpose. For example, for reflectors, for antennas with rotational symmetry, for field and waveguide components, for reflector arrays, transmitter arrays, frequency selective surfaces, polarization selective surfaces, or any other surface with some kind of periodicity. So first, for reflectors, if the reflector is fully lit, then there's really nothing that beats physical optics and physical freeway of diffraction. We don't have to use a mesh. It's basically just a single domain, and we can treat the surface exact in many cases. So for example, for this 50 wavelength offset reflector, it's a parabolic reflector. We compare higher order MFMM and physical optics, and we see that they basically provide identical results. So there's no compromise in terms of accuracy when we use physical optics on a reflector. For speed, the higher order MFMM is already pretty fast, 20 seconds, but with the physical optics algorithm, we have to measure it in milliseconds, which is really a huge advantage if you are optimizing many degrees of freedoms or if you are quantifying a lot of uncertainties. Many antennas also have body of revolution symmetry. For example, on the right here, we see a single patch when we use this solver. The fields and currents do not have to be symmetric. And for the currents, we use a higher order polynomial expansion combined with a Fourier series expansion. So again, of course, we choose the Le Chandra polynomials and the modified Le Chandra polynomials. Here's an example for a 25 wavelength head feed antenna with the smooth walled horn and also a dielectric support. It takes less than a second to solve it on a laptop. And the accuracy is really what you would expect from a full wave higher order solver. We can pull down the error. So when measuring, we get pretty much what we would expect. Another class of problems that we often encounter when analyzing high-gain antennas on spacecraft is passive microwave components and feeds. For example, illustrated here with all the white components in the picture. So for that, we need a variety of methods. mode matching on horns, live at a moment with a cavity greens function, higher order body of revolution bomb, higher order final level method, and higher order method of moment. So all these methods are used on individual components, and then we can use a generalized scattering matrix framework to basically glue together the components and obtain the overall generalized scattering matrix. So that means that we can do a full wave solution of even a complex feed assembly by basically hybridizing all these methods in a rigorous way. At the same time, the generalized scattering matrix frameworks also allows us to reuse components in a very easy manner. For example, on this assembly here, the same waveguide bend is used 6 times. So we, of course, only analyze it once, and the generalized scattering matrix is then reused 6 times. So since we now have physical optics available and we have all these methods for passive microwave components, we can start to look at a more advanced example. For example, this high throughput satellite payload antenna. It's a spot beam antenna, so it generates a lot of individual spot beams on the ground. And in order to have them close together on the ground, we need 4 reflector apertures. This is a very common configuration found on telecommunication satellites. For example, illustrated here with the 2 pictures in the bottom. So each of these 4 reflectors generate 19 beams, and each beam requires a separate feed. So we have 19 feeds per reflector. We now want to optimize these feeds, but the important parameters that we want to optimize are actually parameters that can only be measured on the secondary pattern. So that is the pattern from the reflector. That could be, for example, the beam directivity, the edge of coverage directivity, and the COI, meaning carrier to interference ratio. So we're optimizing this feed cluster with all these feeds. There are 3 different kinds of feeds. We have put 28 optimization variables on the feed geometry, and the reflector is an 80 wavelength reflector. So again, we put the optimization goals on the reflector far field. So that implies that every time we change a variable on the feed, we need to recompute the current on the reflector and recompute the far field. And since we also need the COI, that means that for each beam we compute, we also need to compute all the other beams in order to compute this ratio, which is the disturbance from all the other beams onto a single beam. So here we see the worst case beam performance before and after optimization. And it should be noted that the feeds were already optimized in an isolated configuration. So this is the improvement we get by actually optimizing all the feeds at the same time and by placing the optimization goals on the actual performance parameters on the ground. So the COI ratio has been improved, although we have only changed small variables on the feed geometry. So we optimized this using 29 iterations. It took 2 hours, again on a laptop, where we did 841 objective function evaluations in that time. So that means that for all beams, we used about 9 seconds. So on average, during the optimization, the time for evaluating a single beam was less than 0.5 seconds. So obviously, when you have these ultra-fast methods, you could optimize things that would be completely impossible if you were using a general purpose solver for the optimization. The next class of problems we'll consider is surfaces with periodicity or quasi-periodicity. This could, for example, be reflector rays or transmit rays, frequency selective surfaces, polarizers, or polarization selective surfaces. Here on the right, we've shown 2 examples, a quasi-optical frequency selective surface, which is not periodic, and a deployable reflector ray for CubeSat applications at X-band. Typically, we often encounter printed elements here in layered media because you're building the antenna as a cheap PCB board. In that case, we use a flow K expansion of the fields and currents. So we go to the spectral domain. And again, we prefer to use the higher order basis functions, again, Legendre functions, because they result in increased accuracy for a very limited number of unknowns. When using method of moments in the spectral domain, there's a further advantage of the large patches that we use with higher order basis function, because when it has a large support in the spatial domain, it actually implies that the spectral in the K-space is much more narrow, so we can use fewer flow K modes when summing. Once we have the periodic solder up and running, we can also formulate a method for computing the radiation from a finite quasi-periodic surface. It's based on equivalent currents that we basically extract from this periodic solver. So we can treat both the finiteness of the surface and surface curvature. Here is an example with a reflector ray comparison between simulations and measurements. So we can see that the accuracy is really where it should be. We can use this for accurate design of reflector rays, for example. Another class of problems is when it's not a printed object, but really a 3D object in a 2D lattice. We use a higher order basis functions again, but this time it's a 3D periodic Green's function with Abel acceleration. We have extended it to the case that we are considering here, including also the discontinuous Galerkin integral equation and dielectrics and both finite and infinite dielectric regions. An example is shown here for this unit cell where we have excellent agreement with another solver. So another point we would like to raise today is that if you want to achieve high performance from these quasi-periodic surfaces, then you need to use a direct optimization technique. Typically, people are using the indirect technique, which implies that you select the size of a certain element, for example, a reflector ray element, based on its phase response. So you basically select the elements one by one, and then you compute the final pattern. With a direct optimization, that's only the first step, basically the initial guess, but then you launch a large-scale optimization of all the elements at the same time. So typically you can end up with thousands and thousands of variables, so it's really a large-scale optimization problem, but the performance gets a lot better if you optimize all parameters at one time. So here's an example. It's similar to the high-throughput satellite antenna we considered before with a multi-beam antenna, single feed per beam. So the purpose of this is now to get rid of two of the four reflectors in this four reflector setup. So we've designed a curved reflector array. It's optimized in both transmit at 20 GHz and receive at 30 GHz. It's dual frequency, and it's also a dual circular polarization. The idea is that a single feed should be able to radiate two of the colors in this four color reuse scheme. So it can radiate, for example, both the A and the B beams from a single reflector aperture instead of using two reflectors. The way to achieve that is to design a reflector array on a curved parabola such that a beam tilt is introduced based on the polarization of the incident field. Here we show the optimized beams on the ground at the lowest frequency. As you can see, they are nice and circular. This optimization problem involved more than 50,000 unknowns, and there were 41 beams optimized at the same time, including goals on the carrier to interference ratio. So once you compute one beam, you have to compute all the others to compute the interference. This parabolic curved reflector array was also manufactured by MDA Space in Canada, as shown here. So this gives us the opportunity to compare the measurements and the simulations. The black and the red curves are not supposed to be on top of each other. They are for the neighboring beams in this four-color reuse scheme. But there is a dashed curve and a solid curve, for example, for the black curves, and they are right on top of each other. So this illustrates that although the analysis method is ultra-fast, we can actually still design such an antenna, although it's very complex, with very high accuracy. The optimization problem here involved more than 54,000 variables, but still the full optimization time remains below 24 hours. So another application area where these ultra-fast analysis methods are really important is uncertainty quantification. In particular, for space applications, it's really important to have full control of all the uncertainties involved. So of course, when you manufacture an antenna, you don't always get the exact geometrical size that you requested. You get something which is within a certain tolerance to the nominal size. And using a commercial antenna tool, typically you can only predict the nominal antenna performance, whereas when you build and measure it, it will differ. And that's where you need uncertainty quantification. And in order to do that, you need some really fast analysis methods. So a little bit more about the uncertainty quantification itself. So this plot is taken from a recent conference paper where the author computed the nominal performance and built and measured the antenna and then attempted to explain the differences. And typically the comment was, a good agreement is observed between measurement simulations and the deviations can be explained by manufacturing tolerances. Usually I would characterize a 10 dB difference at a level of minus 10 dB as a very horrific agreement, but the point is that it may actually be pretty good. You don't know unless you have actually quantified your tolerances. So for that purpose, there are a range of new algorithms that are coming out now. Basically, you can use your CM tools to predict the expected performance when subject to manufacturing tolerances. So the expected performance is different from the nominal performance, because the expected performance is the average of all the possible outcomes when you actually build and measure the antenna with a certain tolerance. You can also get confidence intervals, so you basically know that with, for example, 97% certainty, your results should be within the red area of the curve here. So by quantifying the uncertainty, you know if the agreement is good, and you don't have to wave hands and come up with some explanation that may not be true. There are some methods available. The typical classical one is Monte Carlo, where you basically evaluate a large number of random points. But recently, some higher order uncertainty quantification algorithms have been proposed. Stochastic collocation and polynomial chaos expansion, but also a Galerkin approach. These three have the advantage that the function you are quantifying can really be a black box, which is a huge advantage when you're using many hybridized solvers, so you don't have to build uncertainty quantification into the solver itself. But the higher order uncertainty quantification algorithms have really a huge benefit. That's illustrated here, where we compare a Monte Carlo evaluation to a dedicated uncertainty quantification algorithm. On the x-axis, we have the number of function evaluations. On the y-axis, we have the accuracy of the mean value that we are trying to compute of a certain performance parameter. And as we can see, with less than 15 evaluations, we get a much better accuracy, whereas with the Monte Carlo approach, you would need more than 10 to the 8 samples in order to achieve a comparable accuracy. So it's really a huge benefit to use a dedicated uncertainty quantification method. Now we'll try to apply this for something practical. This is an X-band reflectory for ESA's Margo spacecraft. It's a deep space mission that will make a rendezvous with an asteroid. It's supposed to be launched in 23. We have designed this deployable reflectory for that mission. It's a polarizing reflectory, so the feed is linearly polarized, and then the reflectory converts the polarization to circular polarization. On the right here, you can see the model. It's three panels. It's a Roger substrate. We analyze it, of course, with our periodic Mevlon moment using local periodicity, and then we apply the 3D high order MOM on the feed and the CubeSat body. Just to illustrate, we can see here how the reflectory deploys once it's in space, and then the feed pops up, and then the antenna is ready. But of course, there are many degrees of freedom here, and we need to have full control of all the uncertainties. So we have applied our new uncertainty quantification algorithms and our ultra-fast analysis method to this problem. First, we have used it to check whether the etching tolerance of all these small reflectory elements on the substrate, whether the tolerance on that has a significant influence on the patterns. So we had 2,856 variables. We used stochastic collocation, but as you can see here, when we plot the confidence intervals, it really has a very minor impact on the overall shape of the pattern. So based on that, we can conclude that the etching tolerance is not the big problem in this design. So although the number of variables was relatively large, we can solve this in less than an hour. So now we try to check something else. What happens if the panels don't deploy to the right angle, for example, in the root hinge? And what about the substrate thickness and permittivity? Here we have applied the polynomial chaos uncertainty quantification algorithm, And now we see that there is a significant impact on the realized gain here. So the close-ups, you can see that the gain might actually drop by about 0.2 dB if we're unlucky. These are the 97% confidence intervals. Another thing we can get out of this algorithm is the so-called Sobol uncertainty, which shows us the contribution from each variable to the overall uncertainty. So basically here we can see that at theta equal to zero, it's rather blue. That means that the permittivity is governing the uncertainty in this direction. Outside the main beam direction here, it's really the root hinge because the color here is more orange. If we go to the other plane, we can see again that the substrate permittivity is really governing the uncertainties, whereas the root hinge is much less important in this plane. So with that, we know exactly where we should spend the most effort in trying to keep a tight tolerance when manufacturing this. The root hinge and the substrate permittivity is really the important parameters to keep an eye on. Before concluding, we can try to put the developments we have shown today into a greater perspective and talk a bit about the evolution of the antenna design tools and the algorithms we use. So in the beginning, it was only possible to do asymptotic analysis. Then we could do optimization with a few variables. And now today, we have shown full wave analysis of a telecommunication satellite, even at a very high frequency of 60 gigahertz. We can also do large scale optimization of more than 1000 variables. We've also shown that on a curved reflector array with more than 50,000 variables. We can also optimize based on full wave methods because our methods are fast enough for that. And we can apply Monte Carlo uncertainty quantification, at least that's available in many tools. So this is more or less where we are today. That depends a bit on which tool you have and which vendor you have bought your tool from. So if we look into the future, we believe that the next step will be to build in both fast and accurate uncertainty quantification in all antenna tools, because it's really a practical tool that you need. We also believe that in the future we will have a large-scale uncertainty quantification and maybe even based on full-wave solutions, so large-scale meaning more than 1,000 variables. Today we have shown such an example already. And in the future, the holy grail is really to be able to optimize the antenna not on the nominal performance, but on the worst-case performance for the given tolerances. So that means you're basically working on the 97, for example, percent confidence interval and trying to push that down instead of push the nominal performance down. So that is called robust design. It means that in every step of the optimization, we have to run the full uncertainty quantification algorithm. This will be extremely powerful, but it's also an extremely challenging problem. And we have to wait a bit to improve the algorithms and to improve the speed of the available computers before we can actually take advantage of that. So just a small summary of this talk. Basically, space applications come with special requirements. You need very high accuracy, and it's also some electrically large antennas and platforms you're considering. So there's not one algorithm that can do all. You have to look into multiple algorithms, and for design verification, we have looked at this higher order MLFMEM solver, curve mesh elements. We've looked into meshing, high-order Legendre basis functions, discontinuous Galerking for mesh robustness, and then we have shown an MLFMEM scheme tailored to the high-order basis function so we can maintain the nice performance properties. We also have an out-of-core solution if you're out of memory. So with that, for example, we can solve this full-size telecommunication satellite in less than a day on a dual CN computer. So you don't need a supercomputer, although the frequency is very high. If instead you're doing large-scale optimization or uncertainty quantification, you need a completely different class of algorithms. They need to be super fast with evaluation in 1 to 2 seconds. For reflectors, it's physical optics, it's high-order body of evolution, relative moments. There's a range of algorithms for passive microwave components and feeds. It's high-order periodic MOM for quasi-periodic surfaces in both the spectral domain and spatial domain. And with that kind of method available, we can optimize, for example, a curved reflector array in less than a day with 54,000 variables, or we can do uncertainty quantification on more than 1,000 variables. So that's basically all for today. Thanks a lot for listening and for staying. So questions are welcome. You can write me an email, or you can go to our webpage where we have a lot of papers available with all the methods we have talked about here today. And last but not least, I have to thank these six brilliant gentlemen, Oscar, Peter, Ming, Michael, Nils, and Steve, who have contributed a lot to this talk today. So thanks a lot, and bye-bye.